Welcome, everybody. I'm Sam Alkin, Associate Professor in the Department of Food Science, and welcome to our first Food Safety Office Hours for 2023. It's getting hard to really keep track of all the office hours we've done, almost like we need our own digital traceability app so we can recall the ones where I still had hair. Well, all right, maybe that's not a good idea, but it is a good idea for food, and FDA agrees. They've published their final food traceability rule, and there's a little bit in there for everyone to think through from farm to retail. And so today, we're going to have Dr. Betsy Binn, Director of the Produce Safety Alliance, and Dr. Don Stokel discuss some of the resources the Produce Safety Alliance has developed specifically for produce growers. Then we'll hear from Jennifer Trodden, Deputy Commissioner from New York State's Department of Ag and Markets. And then we'll have Melanie Newman, the Executive Vice President and General Counsel for Matrix Sciences International, and Dr. Olga Padilla-Zacor, Director of the Cornell Food Venture Center, join us for a panel Q&A on the traceability rule. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Betsy to kind of take us away on this traceability rule.
Okay. Hopefully everybody should see my screen now.
Looks great.
Okay, fantastic. Super happy that we could be here today. I think the key thing we want to say right up front is we initially developed this slide set for the produce industry, as you can see here, but because IFS has a lot of different commodities, and I saw some of my colleagues who are definitely in other areas besides produce, Don and I went through and added slides to really try and encompass a broader perspective, but do want to make it clear that that is not our areas of expertise, so be patient with us. Don is also, so how this is going to go is I'm going to present the slides. Don is going to jump in when we hit something that was asked as a question prior to the thing so that we're kind of doing due diligence on this. And we're going to try and go at a decent clip so that we have time for Jen and for Melanie and for other folks that want to add in. So that's what today is going to look like. Okay. I don't know why it's not advancing. Give me 1 second. Oh, there it is. Okay. So as Sam just said, the traceability rule is final. So we're going to talk about the FSMA traceability rule, which is FSMA 204. Some people refer to that. We're going to go over some compliance start dates, who and what is covered, and talk about specific information for produce farms where we can, and then leave you with resources that are available. The first thing I want to point out is that the traceability rule is a FSMA rule. So the folks you are working with may be also subject to the produce safety rule or the preventive controls rule for human food or animal food, and also be subject to the traceability rule. It is its own rule. That's really important, I think, to recognize. The other thing that is critically important is to know that the compliance date for all operations is January 20th of 2026. Now, I know it's COVID years, but for everybody, we are in 2023. That's 3 years away. That gives you time to start working on this and put things in place so that when compliance happens, you're ready. The other thing I want to highlight is that it's the compliance date for all operations. Now in produce, we usually have 3 compliance dates because different sized operations come in at different times. But for this particular rule, all operations are going to come into compliance on January 20th, 2026. And that's because FDA said, you need to understand that unlike other rules, the entire distribution system is involved here. So that's why the compliance dates for all operations is on that day, okay? Now, this is where we start to step outside the area of produce. So there are specific foods covered on the food traceability list, FTL, food traceability list. Cheeses, other than hard cheeses, shell eggs, nut butters, ready-to-eat deli salads, fresh and frozen finfish, smoked finfish, fresh and frozen molluscan bivalves, fresh and frozen crustaceans. All right. From the produce side, all types and varieties, if covered by the produce safety rule, so again, you have to refer back to the produce safety rule though, cucumbers, herbs, leafy greens, fresh cut leafy greens, melons, peppers, sprouts, tomatoes, tropical tree fruits, fresh cut fruits and vegetables. Okay, so there you go. Those are the list of things that are covered. And we're going to talk a little bit about exemptions because there's a lot of them and you need to pay attention to that as we move forward. You will find exemptions under 1.1305. And starting right off the bat, you'll see certain produce farms are not covered. If you're exempt from the produce safety rule, PSR, you are exempt from the traceability rule, except that some produce safety rule qualified exempt farms, they may be required to provide traceability information for buyers that are not qualified end users. Now, there's a lot of words there that I'm not going to take the time to go into depth on because we don't have the time, but it's important if you're a produce person or working with produce to recognize sort of where this falls.
And Betsy, this is one area where there was a question beforehand to confirm that if you are a produce safety rule covered, but you are eligible for a qualified exemption, all the other exemptions and exclusions in produce safety rule also apply to traceability rule. But that one, if you're a qualified exempt farm, you still may need to follow some of the traceability rule requirements.
Thank you, Don, for jumping in. This is working great. So certain shell egg producers. This subpart does not apply to shell egg producers with fewer than 3,000 laying hens at a particular farm with respect to the shell eggs they produce at that farm. What you're going to find is we're giving you these caveats, right? And you're going to see a note coming up soon. You really got to read the details of this to find out if you're subject to this rule. I've said it once, I'll say it again. Other producers of raw agricultural commodities, so producers other than fresh produce and shell eggs, such as aquaculture operations, when the average annual monetary value of their sales and the market value of the racks they manufacture, process, pack, or hold without sale, e.g. held for a fee, during the previous three-year period is no more than $25,000 on a rolling basis, adjusted for inflation using 2020 as the baseline year for calculating that adjustment. A couple of things are really important in here. Understanding the monetary value and understanding what year that's based on inflation, right? Because for different rules, it's going to be based on different years of inflation, same $25,000 level. Okay. All right. There's more exempt or not covered information under 1.1305. All food sold or donated directly by the farm to a consumer. Food packaged on the farm may be exempt. The packaging must protect against contamination and remain intact to consumers. This is, you'll notice, where I added some bolding, right? Again, pointing out you got to be clear who you are. Some commingled raw agricultural commodities. Food that was or will be processed with a kill step. For produce, anyone will recognize this as an area that gets you out of the produce safety rule as well. Foods that are changed so that they're no longer on the food traceability list. Has it been modified to something else so it's no longer on the FTL list? Some school lunch and institutional food programs. Certain small retail food establishments, also called RFEs, and restaurants, or food bought from a farm by any RFE or restaurant. Okay, so if you're just selling to these certain retail food establishments or you're selling direct to restaurants, you may be exempt from this rule.
Oh, Betsy, that is, sorry, I hate to break in, but it's the other way. The retail food establishment or the restaurant may be exempt, but the farm is not in that one.
Thank you, Don. Thank you for that clarification. I should have read that in the right direction. Nonprofit food establishments, owners and operators of fishing vessels and transporters, they got added here because we didn't have them on the last one with the chicken producers. All right.
Hold there for just a second. There was a question about farmers markets. And I just want to point out that first exemption, food sold or donated directly by a farm is exempt. So in this case, it is the farm that is exempt. So a farm that's selling at a farmer's market, provided it's being sold to the consumer, those sales would be exempt.
Right. So, and I want to go back and re-say that. So the deal is that first one is the farm, the farm becomes exempt, right? When we get back to the one where I said certain small retail food establishments, it's the small retail food establishments that could be exempt. So to highlight that, both farms and retail establishments could be exempt and restaurants could be exempt, right? If they meet these requirements. All right. Even more, this was one of my favorite parts when we were going through the review of this rule as a team. There are provisions for waivers to the traceability rule. Okay, so if you're not exempt from all of the things that we just said, there are provisions that you can get a waiver. FDA will waive a requirement on their own initiative. So FDA can decide, oh, we've decided this group is out on their own. They can make that. Or in response to a written request from an individual entity or a citizen petition. Now, again, I've added more terms there. You have to go back and read who would be defined as an individual entity and who would and how would a citizen petition work. But we wanted to point out that you can get a waiver and not be subject to this rule, right? And the exemptions and exclusion tool is listed there and also listed in the last slide of this presentation for more information. And we might be able to put that in the chat box as well. All right, this is the key thing. We highly recommend those covered review 1.1305 to go through all this. It is very detailed. There's a lot of very interesting information to help you decide. There's also the tool that we just pointed out to know whether or not you're legally subject to this rule. And we have Melanie. I think she just turned on her camera. So she'll be able to walk us through that as well. Now there's commodity exclusions. Okay, so we went ahead and pasted all of these in here. So for cheeses, it does not include cheeses that are frozen, shelf stable at ambient temperature or aseptically processed and packaged. Nut butters does not include soy or seed butters. Fresh and frozen molluscan bivalves does not include scallop adductor mussels, raw bivalve molluscan shellfish that are covered by the requirements of the National Shellfish Sanitation Program, right? These producers are subject to other rules. They're exempt if they're there, subject to the requirements of 21 CFR Part 123, Subpart C, and 21 CFR 1240.60, or covered by a final equivalence determination by FDA for raw bivalve molluscan shellfish. Again, the point is there are exemptions in here, and if this is you, you need to pay attention. So these folks are exempt from the requirements of the rule under this exemption. Sorry, my computer is not very responsive to my clicker. Herbs, those listed in 21 CFR 112-2A1, which is the rarely consumed raw list. For all of you that are used to produce safety and you're used to hearing us say rarely consumed raw list, that is the provision number there, such as dill, are exempt from the requirements of the rule. All right. Leafy greens does not include whole head cabbage, such as green cabbage, red cabbage, or Savoy cabbage. Savoy is the crinkly cabbage for you, for those of you that may not know that. Does not include banana leaf, grape leaf, and leaves that are grown on trees. Leafy greens listed in 112-2A1, again, the rarely consumed raw list, such as collards, are exempt from the requirements of the rule. Okay, so again, more exemptions based on commodity. The tree fruit one is very interesting. Does not include non-tree fruits such as bananas, pineapples, dates, soursop, jujube, passion fruit, loquat, pomegranate, sapodilla, and figs. Does not include tree nuts such as coconut. Does not include pit fruits such as avocados. Does not include citrus such as orange, clementine, tangerine, mandarins, lemon, lime, citrus, grapefruit, kumquat, and pomelo. All right. Again, lots of things on this list. So that ends our list of exemptions and weird exclusions based on commodity. But we wanted to share those because we think it's really important that people understand if they are or are not subject to this rule. We're moving to some key terms we want you to know. We've already talked about the food traceability list, which we refer to as the FTL, and that is the list of foods covered under this rule. Critical tracking events include things such as harvesting, initial packing, receiving, cooling, shipping, and transformation. We call those CTEs moving forward in some of our nomenclature. Key data elements, KDEs, are records related to these critical tracking events that must be created and maintained. Some must follow the product, right? There's traceability lot code, and that will identify each lot, it says here, of produce, but it would identify each lot of whatever it is you're selling. And that's really important because that gets assigned at a certain part, and then there's responsibilities that come with assigning that traceability lot code. Initial packing for raw agricultural commodities and transformation are two steps where the traceability lot code can be assigned for foods on the FTL. So let's go back to the beginning. You have food that is listed on the food traceability list. At those events, initial packing and transformation, that's where you're going to assign the traceability lot code. And then you're going to be responsible for gathering some of these critical tracking events and key data elements. And we have a graphic coming up to try and work through that. You're also required to have a location description, which is the business name, phone number, and location, or GPA or address or GPS. Think about farms. There's not an address up to there where the critical tracking events happened. All right. So who is covered? Persons who manufacture, process, pack, or hold foods that appear on the food traceability list. And I want to make clear that you have to understand all of those words and what those words mean. Manufacture, process, pack, or hold, and who's involved in that. The example we have here is cucumbers. Again, going back to the fact that we work with fresh produce growers. But you can see here on the screen, all the way from the farm to the retail food establishment, that's the supply chain that's involved in this. And you'll see a note here that the initial packer, if there is an initial packer, or the processor where the transformation happens, would be the group or those individuals to apply that traceability lot code. That's where the lot code is going to be assigned. Now, the farm may assign a traceability lot code for their own needs, right? Even if they're not covered. But when it comes to this rule, that traceability lot code is going to be assigned there. So everyone is required to have a traceability plan to identify which foods they're growing that are on the FTL and the activities. Now, they may not need to have a traceability lot code if they're not responsible for doing it, like the farm, not responsible for doing it, but they have to have this traceability plan that has a farm map, point of contact, and procedures for maintaining those records. Okay, that's a requirement for everyone. Now, when it moves to KDEs, key data elements, or CTEs, that is going to depend on where you are in that process, where you are subject to these rules, and it depends on what your operation does in terms of critical tracking events, which key data elements you need to collect. All right. Any questions here, Don? Did we have any questions on this part?
Well, there was one, and I missed it. If you go back a step,
okay, sorry.
I was going to pick it up. Go back to the cucumber supply chain.
Okay.
There was a question about how this applies to a facility, whether traceability applies to a facility.
Packing facility?
Yeah, a facility, something under the preventive control.
It was a qualified facility, sorry.
Qualified facility. Thanks, yeah. Sam.
Yeah. Okay.
And so you can see on this chain that if the processor, say it's sliced cucumbers, is a qualified facility, then they would be covered under traceability rule at that step of processing.
Okay.
So just wanted to confirm that this applies not just to farms, harvest operations, coolers, but also to facilities.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, and I just reiterate, yeah. So if you're a qualified facility and you have exemptions from the preventative controls for human foods, you are still required to comply with the traceability rule if you're handling a food that is on that list.
Yeah.
Or transforming a food that's on that list. Yep.
Yes, those words, very important. Transforming, yes. Right?
Transforming is a big word because transforming is not just processing and manufacturing. Transforming is something as simple as repacking or relabeling. So it's important to know those words.
Right. Boy, we could spend like hours on this webinar instead of our 20 minutes we were allotted. All right. So just to step you back here, we were on this slide before we went backwards, these KDEs and these CTEs, right? So you have critical tracking events, and those critical tracking events then trigger you to collect key data elements for each of those. Then once the traceability lot code is assigned, it is passed forward to the next recipient in the chain and connects those critical tracking events. Now you remember, and you're going to see the slide coming up again, but remember that traceability lot code is assigned by that initial packer or that initial transformer, right? And what then happens is these critical tracking events, such as initial packing, shipping, receiving, transforming, they now have to get those KDEs that were related to harvest, right? Or those KDEs that were related to cooling, if there was any. And so that person who assigns that traceability lot code needs to go back and make sure they have all the relevant KDEs at that initial packing step. All right. And then they will then pass that traceability lot code forward to whoever the product goes to. So here's that example scenario from FTE trying to coalesce everything we've talked about. The blue box is circulating everybody in that supply chain, right? Everybody needs to have a plan. But you'll note here on this example that the farm doesn't have any KDEs, but the harvester does, right? And the cooler has some KDEs. Now you see that initial packer, the initial packing KDEs, the shipping KDEs, and they're going to be assigning that traceability lot code at that point. Then you move to the produce processor, distributor, and you can see along that line where those other KDEs come in to be based on those critical tracking events. All right, so that's the summary slide. And puts us right on time to tell you here's some additional resources for you to use. The one I do want to highlight, first of all, so there's the traceability rule. If you haven't seen it, please download it and look at it. There's a food traceability list. There's that exemption and exclusions tool we talked about. There is an FDA webinar about traceability if you want to see what FDA had to say about it. I do want to highlight this FSMA Technical Assistant Network, or the TAN. We were talking to FDA yesterday, and one of the requests they made for this presentation was that if you submit something to the TAN, please provide them with as many details as you can so that they can help you understand if you're subject to the rule and where you fit in the process, right? So the more details, the better. They can give you a better answer if you give them better details. There's also a link to the Produce Safety Alliance webinar about traceability rule. Keep in mind, we're produce people, so if you're an egg person, it may not be as helpful. And then there's the link to the guidance document created by New York State Department of Ag and Markets, which I think Jen is going to talk about next. And with that, what I will say is, again, today was a highlight. It was not a comprehensive look. Remember, those compliance dates do not come in until January 20th of 2026. That's almost a full 3 years away. You should be very familiar with the traceability list, as well as who is and who is not covered and what is and is not covered. And here's my plea to you. If you are subject to the rule, please start working on it now. It will give you plenty of time to test the system and to make sure you have all those pieces in place. And with that, I do want to thank the PSA team at large, since they really worked on the slides together. There's our website, and I will stop sharing and hand it back to my IFS CU colleagues.
That was a great presentation. Yeah, and there's a lot still to digest, but, you know, we'll keep carrying it forward.
I think we were right on time, right?
Right on time.
Thanks, Don, for jumping in with those questions, too, and the clarification.
And so now we'll pass it over to Jennifer Trodden, the Deputy Commissioner from New York Ag and Markets.
Thank you, Sam, and thank you, Betsy. That was a really great overview. What I wanted to do is complement some of the information that Betsy shared to just kind of share what we in New York State had proposed, actually, almost the same time the produce traceability was being proposed. So our timing was actually spot on. But the reason, you know, I wanted to just give you an overview of the how and the why we came up with what we're going to call the New York State Produce Traceability Blue Ribbon Task Force and subsequent documentation and guidance document we put together for that. So the why we came up with this idea of creating a guidance document to track and trace produce was as a result of an outbreak investigation that occurred back in November 2018. And all of you that are in the produce industry know very well, and you're very well aware of this event. It was the day before Thanksgiving when all romaine lettuce was pulled off every single shelf and out of distribution as a result of this outbreak. So fast forward, as a result of a State of the State initiative through our governor in 2020, he announced that we will put together a produce traceability task force. The idea behind the task force was to create this group to be able to analyze and recommend best practices that the industry was currently using, so that those types of practices could be utilized by New York State growers, packers, distributors, and retailers, to provide a superior level of traceability specifically for produce in New York State. So we formed this Blue Ribbon Task Force. It included all representatives from throughout the entire food system. We wanted to understand the concerns and challenges associated with the traceability system and creating a traceability system. We wanted this group to think broadly and bring solutions forward. In addition to thinking about the concerns and challenges, what are those solutions that we could come up with to alleviate those concerns and challenges? And this was the very beginning stages of produce traceability. So everybody over the several meetings that we had agreed that this was still such a great approach and a good thing to do. So the task force met many times, all virtually, unfortunately, because we were right in the middle of COVID. But we kicked things off by creating a pre-survey in the summer of 2020. We got the group together in November of that same year to kind of really go over their feedback, gather as much information as we could from them using some of the questions that were outlined in the survey to really stimulate the conversation. We then subsequently met them two subsequent times after that, sharing the documentation that we were creating all along, getting their feedback, changing direction as they kind of directed us to do so. And then we finally released the document in April 2022. And the link to the document is right there on the screen. And I think Don also provided a link. So at the same time we were doing this work, FDA announced the first version of the traceability rule in September 23rd, 2020. That is when we identified and saw for the first time that there were 16 foods that were being targeted that Betsy outlined already, 9 of which though were related to produce. So as Betsy kind of covered already, the foods were limited. They are limited by the rule based on risk. They do include biological hazards, acute chemical toxins that have an immediate public health risk. The comment period is closed and the rule is final right now. But while this work was ongoing at the same time as FDA was doing their work, everyone on the Blue Ribbon Task Force felt that it was very important for us to move forward with this guidance and include every sector of the produce supply chain rather than just the 9 that were identified by the FDA. Also at the same time, FDA announced a competition through their new era of smarter food safety, where they were looking for companies to come forward with low or no cost tech-enabled traceability systems. This is actually really, really great that they did this, and we were able to use some of the information that they put together as a result of this competition, and we included it in the guidance document. What was really important about this competition was that the fact that they identified low or no cost tech-enabled traceability systems. So one of the concerns and challenges that we had heard from the task force was where they talked about the cost of trying to implement a traceability system, but that cost was a barrier to that implementation. So the fact that we have a list of these really great organizations that can provide these low or no cost tools, we felt really good about that. So we put together this best management practices document, really designed to strengthen the produce supply chain here in New York. It was based, as I mentioned, on the feedback that we received from the task force. We also wanted to identify the challenges that the task force had outlined to us as major barriers to implementation, because the cost was a major barrier. So we wanted to include as much of that information as possible so that we were upfront so that those that were looking or seeking to implement a system had all of the information in front of them before they made any decisions. So this is just an example of what the document looks like. We have a table of contents. We have it set up so that it's basically a step-by-step system. We also incorporated the ideas and a lot of the information that was in the proposed rule for traceability at the time. So the CTEs and KDEs that Betsy talked about already, we incorporated that in this document, and thinking that that's how it was going to land in the end. So I was happy that we actually included all that. So we also identified roles and components of a traceability system. So what's important about that, and it looks very close to the flowchart that Betsy showed you guys already. You know, we wanted to identify the roles in, and each person that's part of the system does have a role in ensuring that the traceability system is complete and it's connected. Another major challenge and some of the feedback we received was that the connectivity between each part of the supply chain seemed to lose connectivity throughout the system. So in that, somebody at the very beginning of the supply chain could have a really great traceability system, and then when they pass it forward to the next part of the chain, if those systems do not connect, you lose, you know, a lot of the work that you're doing early on or subsequently after the fact. So our first idea was to, you know, as I mentioned, this is a step-by-step process, identify through a simple flow diagram, the flow of food through your facility or farm, so that you're identifying, again, back to the KDEs and CTEs, which parts of the supply chain you do need to have connectivity to the next part of the supply chain. We also identified the idea of having establishing lot identifying codes. So a little different terminology, but the same kind of intent that Betsy talked about creating this traceability lot code. We had the same idea and same intent established here. And then our last step is record keeping. So there's a variety of different records that do need to be maintained. We mimicked the records that are outlined in the traceability rule in this document, so that those, if anyone wanted to use this guidance document to create a traceability system, and they also need to apply or comply with traceability rule, they will basically have been able to do that by killing two birds with one stone, essentially. In addition to the step-by-step guidance and all of the information that I shared already, we also created a traceability resources list. Why we created this list was that this document is relatively short. I think it's only 15 pages long. There are several documents that are published on the internet that are hundreds of pages long. So if somebody wanted a really complex traceability system, they certainly could mimic those systems by using any of the resources that we have outlined here. And then lastly, we have a significant number of appendices. What's important about these appendices is that the information that's listed in these appendices primarily came from the task force. So we used some of the best management practices or documents or templates that they currently use themselves and created, you know, somewhat of an appendix or the list of documents that are listed here in the appendix to try and guide people using visuals or using systems and templates that other people use already to help them implement their own traceability system. And that is all I have. So, you know, our general feedback from the task force is that they were happy that wanted to get their feedback, received their feedback, and put the guidance document together based on their feedback. They were also very willing to implement and explore the implementation of a produce traceability system that was not just limited to the 9 produce commodities or produce types that are listed on the current traceability rule. That's all I have. Thank you.
Can I jump in here, Jen, too?
Yeah.
I think one of the most interesting things about the group was the honest discussion of where the challenges lie. And I think Jen really hit on this when she was talking about available technology, because the issue really becomes the handoff of the information. How do you hand it off in a secure way? How do you not share too much information that could put your business at risk, right? And all those. I think one of the other things that came up was for operations that do a lot of cash sales, that was a big area that was identified as challenging. And I think this document has been really great. The number of appendices and additional information is very helpful to people. So a lot of credit to NYSDAM for starting it before we had the traceability rule, but I think it is a very nice document that will supplement information you may need as you move forward with traceability law compliance.
Yeah, well, it's a great resource. And right there, right? You have the whole thing outlined for you to follow. So